laws.
Right. Now, if you, not everyone lives by a beach and they want to do art, or as long as it's advertised as homemade tumbled glass, there's nothing wrong with that, just like tumbled stones. But you have to let people know what they're buying. You can't advertise it as sea glass because it's not sea glass. And by the way, in the Midwest, along the lakes, they call it beach glass. So to me, it's free. I find it on the beach. That here's a piece. Okay, so this isn't tumbled too bad. That's the top of a bottle.
Right, rim on it on the top.
On the top. But it's, I call this mid-tumbled for me. So I would put this back. This is kind of the sea glass, unwritten rule, if you want to call it. If you find a piece of glass that's tumbled and you don't want it, or it's a color you're not, you leave it. You leave it. Someone else is going to come find it. The tide's not danger.
It's like you threw a fish back.
Right, exactly.
It's too small.
Here's another piece. So this is a nice little piece. Now I'll use that piece because it looks like a wave. My art, see how that be a wave? And you'll find interesting pieces that have dates or little figurines, and just, you know, half of the fun is trying to identify that piece of glass.
I'm sorry, I'm not listening to you.
That's a green
little
one.
Little tiny
now, this
green.
One looks like a little sail, so I'll use that for a sailboat on some of my night lights. Now the purples, back in the 50s, they made glass with manganese. When it reacts with the UV rays, it turns purple. So if you have glass that have a purplish tint, you can take that and put it on a baking pan. They turn really purple. Yes, here you go.
I found a green.
Found a green. That's a nice little one.
Yeah.
Well tumbled.
You say this is your church.
It is. It's my, I call it my sanctuary. It's like I come here, it helps me find a better me. That's really what it is. You know, I have my struggles. I have in the past. And my favorite time of year is this year, when it cools down and the crowds disappear, because then it's my beach again. I like this. Oh, yeah.
Ah, I found something.
Yes.
Our visit with sea glasser David Lee Valley on Boston's Revere Beach. For pictures, go to herenow.org.
Hi, I'm Nina Totenberg. Are you someone who talks about how great public radio is, but you're still not a donor? Rather than wait for the next pledge drive, you can support the programs you love by donating that unwanted vehicle. Donate it today. It could be worth hundreds of dollars to this station, and you could get a tax deduction. Or you could just give us hundreds of dollars directly. We'd like that a lot. And thank you.
For more information, go to our website, radioiq.org.
With Election Day quickly approaching, many voters are still wondering what a Kamala Harris presidency would look like, including her foreign policy.
Voters are going to be asking themselves what Harris would do differently to draw some clear contrast with the outgoing Biden administration to show how she would inject new life into U.S. foreign policy.
That's on the next On Point.
Weekday evenings at 7 on Radio IQ.
Funding for Here and Now comes from MathWorks, creators of MATLAB and Simulink software for technical computing and model-based design. MathWorks, accelerating the pace of discovery in engineering and science. Learn more at mathworks.com. And WBUR presenting the internet culture podcast Endless Thread. Feed your curiosity with untold histories, unsolved mysteries, and stories about technology, memes, and madness. Endless Thread. Listen wherever you get your podcasts.
It's Here and Now. Free meals in schools. You may have heard VP candidate Tim Walz talking about it in his state of Minnesota. Seven other states also offer universal free meals to students. And the numbers show more and more students are showing up for free breakfast and lunch. Thing is, that participation is helping put several programs over budget, and other states are watching to see how it's going. Kaylin Belsha has written about this. She is national reporter at Chalkbeat, the nonprofit education news outlet, and Chalkbeat is an editorial partner of ours. Hi, Kaylin.
Hey, Scott. Thanks for having me on.
Good to have you. Are there measurable benefits of free breakfast and lunch for students, say links to better nutrition, links to better education outcomes?
Yeah, there's a couple different kinds of benefits that have been researched. The first is that often universal meals, when you survey families at home, it leads to less food insecurity at home, likely because families have more to spend on groceries. We've also seen there's some research that shows that it can help improve school attendance and it can lower discipline. And in some cases, it can improve test scores. Not all research has found that. But on the discipline front, the thinking is that there's less stigma and fewer kids are being bullied for taking free lunches. It kind of makes there less tension in the lunchroom.
Kaylin, your story notes that more and more students are showing up for universal free meals in the 8 states that offer it. Have you spoken to students and teachers in those places? I'm curious what they tell you about how they feel about the free meals, how it's going.
Yeah, I've talked to some of the school nutrition directors who are talking with students and with teachers about how it's going. Yeah. And I've heard a couple different things. Sometimes, kids are still saying it's still school meals, but there's definitely been a shift that we've seen because a lot of times when you do these universal programs, they take in more money. And so these programs are able to afford things they couldn't before, more fresh fruits and vegetables, and they can often offer higher quality ingredients. And kids really like that. So we've definitely seen a shift toward kind of cooking more recipes that sometimes families enjoy more. I have a friend who said that her kids rush to school to get the free smoothies in the morning. They really, really like it. So in the places where there's been some innovation, I think that kids are really excited about that.
Yeah. And just to understand the increased funding that comes in, is it that the school districts that participate, they receive more funding to kind of reimburse them, to help them pay for this? And that's why they have money for, smoothies, other things?
Yeah, exactly. So because the states are helping to foot the bill, the school districts are getting money from the federal government to help reimburse for the meals. And then also the state is kicking in more money. So the school districts are taking in more than they would have before.
Mm-hmm. Now, you're right that many states offering universal free school meals are seeing their costs go over budget, because of demand, because of food inflation. How are states responding to this challenge?
Yeah, I mean, I think all the states that I chatted with, they told me that they've been trying to take some concrete steps, such as making sure that all the schools that can be getting the most federal reimbursement are doing so. There's a lot of kind of paperwork that's involved in that, making sure that kids are being tracked properly. And that just takes a little bit of time to set up. The federal government has changed the rules a little bit over the last few years. So some of that's just kind of paperwork. But then there's also been some who've hired consultants to try to make sure they're keeping their costs down. And they're also just in general doing better modeling because now they have a couple months or years of data to work with. Before, people were going off of their pandemic numbers, and those were just not very good predictors because there was so much instability during that time. Kids weren't coming to school at the same rate. And so now there's just better numbers to work with.
Is there any momentum for more than these 8 states to offer universal free meals, or is there any momentum, say, in Congress to make this a national thing?
In Congress, this has really been at a standstill. We saw some effort after the pandemic to try to extend this nationally, and that did not go anywhere. Congressional Republicans were really opposed to the cost. So there is legislation in Congress, but it hasn't gone anywhere. We have seen some states trying to push for this. Illinois, for example, did pass a law, but then didn't fund it. And we've seen some movement in Republican-controlled states to cover the cost of reduced price meals. So those are still for children who are very low income, but it is still an expansion. So I think it is a real question of how far this can go, because in some states there isn't really momentum.
Yeah, but as you're saying, it sounds like it may have some political currency to expand school lunches, but not necessarily make it universal for all students?
Exactly, yes. There's some movement to kind of cover it for more kids, but maybe not all kids.
Yeah, okay. And finally, I'm just curious, what struck you when you were talking or perhaps visiting about the specific meals some of these schools are serving?
I think I was really impressed. I talked with some of the school nutrition directors in Vermont about the ways that they were able to make more things in-house. They said that they'd always wanted to do that, but they just didn't have the money to do it. And this allowed them to buy a nice meat processing machine that makes meatballs really, really fast. And so they had this meatball dish that the kids really loved, but the school staff could only scoop so fast. And they said that investing in this $25,000 machine made it so that the kids could eat meatballs a lot more often.
Okay.
And they're cooking bread in the morning. happening. I mean, these are the kinds of things that we really didn't get to see very much, right. And I think it is okay. Improving quality.
Caitlin Belcher of Chalkbeat, thanks so much.
Thank you so much.
Here and Now is a production of NPR and WBUR. I'm Scott Tong in Washington, D.C.
I'm Robin Young in Boston. It's Here and Now.
Funding for Here and Now comes from the listeners of WBUR Boston, where the program is produced, and your NPR station, and the Music Emporium, guitar sellers for more than 50 years, celebrating the enduring presence of music made on the front porch and center stage. You can learn more at themusicemporium.com.
This week on This American Life.
This is a case of Henry D. number C.
Parole board hearings are this weird backwater of the judicial system that doesn't get a lot of scrutiny. This week, we listen in as board members discuss one case. We see people get persuaded as they try to adjudicate these very squishy, nearly impossible questions, like when is a person rehabilitated? What is justice? That's this week.
Monday evenings at 8 and Saturday afternoons at 3 on Radio IQ.
Support for Radio IQ is provided by the Mirius Group, a private wealth advisory practice of Ameriprise Financial Services, LLC, providing investment and planning services for more than 50 years. The Mirius Group at Ameriprise.
The October 21st, 2024 meeting of Roanoke City Council is hereby called to order, and I will ask Clerk Ms. Susan McCoy to please call the roll.
Ms. Whiteboy.
Here.
Mr. Volleson.
Here.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Here.
Ms. Sanchez Jones.
Here.
Mr. Fitzpatrick is out today. Vice Mayor Cobb.
Here.
And Mayor Lee.
Here. Ms. Horn, present. The invocation today will be delivered by the Reverend Terry Kemp, Children's Pastor and Ministries Director of the Fort Chiswell Church of God. Following the invocation, I will lead you in a Pledge of Allegiance. But prior to that, I want everybody to stand and we want to have a moment of silence for Mr. Walter Clinton Rogers. He's a security officer, longtime security officer at William Fleming High School, who passed away on October the 13th. And So if you would, join me in a moment of silence for Mr. Rogers. Thank you. Let's Kim.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for this day, for your grace and your blessings you have bestowed upon us each day. We thank you for the opportunity to live and serve in this city and for the talents and abilities you've given each and every one of us. We ask your blessing on each member of this council and our city leaders and their responsibilities to represent all citizens of this city in a professional and impartial manner. We pray for wisdom and vision in our endeavors to put forth our best efforts for the benefits of this community and for your glory. Let us acknowledge the importance of each viewpoint here today so that we may partner together in our efforts to achieve ongoing success. We pray for your divine inspiration for decisions made in this chamber today and in the days to come, and to keep your protective hand over our city. Almighty God, inspire us to even greater achievements as the city of Roanoke continues to be a leading example of civic progress and partnership. May each of us approach our daily responsibilities with integrity and a desire for excellence to benefit the citizens of this great city. We also pray for guidance in this election season, that our nation will not be divided by political differences, but let us be united in our continual pursuit to remain the global leader in democracy and freedom. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Reverend Kemp. Thank you.
A lot of people just backing out, man.
Oh. All right, welcome everybody to our first session of Roanoke City Council for today. And I'm going to begin with our announcements. The Council of the City of Roanoke is seeking applications for various vacancies on council-appointed authorities, boards, commissions, and committees. And as we do each and every meeting that we have, we invite citizens to come forward, or willing, those who are willing to come forward and be part of these various committees that we appoint to help us govern our city. You can either access the city's website at www.roanokeva.gov to complete an online application. It's a very easy process, and if you have any questions, you can always call our clerk's office, and she will, they will provide us the guidance that you need. So we're looking for those who want to serve. And I think you really enjoy the process. All right, I'm pleased to recognize our deputy city manager that's sitting in the city manager's place, our deputy city manager Samuel Romans, so we can direct all complex issues and things that we may have. Deputy Romans is here to work those through. Thank you.
Thank you
for your presence here. And also recognize that deputy city manager, Angel Bryant, who's here, in case Sam tries to figure that out. We'll come to you, Sam. All right, welcome everybody. All right, presentations and acknowledgments is our next item on the agenda. And we have a proclamation declaring October 24th as Domestic Violence Awareness Month. And I'm going to call on Miss Lena Loenko. I know I didn't do that name any justice, but Lena, you understand. And also, I want to recognize Jessica Pruitt from TAP. So thank you both, and I will join you down at the podium. And I'm not going to call on Doug Jackson, our arts and culture person, but he's here in the building. Hey, how you doing? Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you. You know, domestic violence is real personal to me. I remember back in 2005, we started the first task force in Roanoke dealing with domestic violence. And it's a combination of people in our community, our Commonwealth attorney. Our delegate at that time, William Fralin, was a part of that committee, and probation and parole officers, both juvenile and adults, because we wanted to put emphasis on domestic violence. And through that task force, we were able to obtain additional staff for our police department that dealt only with domestic violence. So I'm just so proud to be a part of that and to have been a part of that. And so this is Domestic Violence Month, so y'all can say a few words, so you got it, or you want to read the proclamation. Are you prepared to do that?
I can say a few words.
Okay, let me read this proclamation and we'll do that. All right. The National Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Whereas the month of October has been recognized as National Domestic Violence Awareness Month for the past 35 years, since being first declared by the United States Congress in 1989. Whereas nationally, one in three women and one in seven men experience intimate partner violence. Whereas more than 4,000 women die each year as a result of domestic violence. Whereas 77% of survivors experience violence upon leaving their abuser. 75% experience an increase in violence for the first 2 years after leaving their abuser, within the first 18 months being the most dangerous. Whereas survivors are three times more likely to engage in self-harming behaviors, three times more likely to have suicidal thoughts, four times more likely to attempt suicide. Whereas nationally, domestic violence incidents rose during the stresses of the COVID pandemic, and in Roanoke, domestic violence-related calls to police increased by 40% in 2023. Whereas an exhibition of embroidery created through survival workshops in partnerships with artist Lena Lorden Cole and Omar. Okay.
Yeah.
I got you. We got it.
We got it.
And I'll give you a chance to come up and share that. And Total Action for Progress is now on display in the first floor of the Noel C. Taylor Municipal Building. And whereas this exhibit points to paths of healing, support, and community resources available for the region's residents, including a 24 hotline, which the number is 540-580-0775. Now, therefore, I, Sherman P. Lee, Sr., Mayor of the City of Roanoke, Virginia, call upon its citizens to seek assistance and support family members, friends, and neighbors who may be victims of physical, psychological, financial, or sexual abuse, and do hereby proclaim October 24th throughout this great eight-time All-American city as National Domestic Violence Awareness Month. And I'm pleased to recognize these citizens who have come up to talk about this and share with you their thoughts on it. Lynn?
Thank you. I want to say thank you to the Roanoke Arts Commission and Doug Jackson. I have been wanting to do a project like this for 5 years or more. And finally, everything came together where I had an opportunity through the city to do so. So before I even applied for this project, I sent Doug an email saying, is this viable and would the city or Roanoke Arts Commission support it? And he said, absolutely, please apply. And was a really big advocate for this project. So thank you, Doug. Thank you to the Roanoke Arts Commission. And thank you to the city for supporting this. Survivors are often silenced in very suffocating ways. And I'm a little bit emotional about it. Excuse me. I want to thank Total Action for Progress, who saved my life when I left my abuser. I'd like to thank Jessica Pruitt, who's next to me, who saw my initial post on Instagram announcing the project. She has been there every step of the way to help with any questions or logistical issues that have come up. And there were a lot, because this is both a public and private project where we are helping survivors learn to create art while keeping them safe, while providing something that is family friendly and can account for childcare, transportation, where they can take the supplies home without worrying about potential abusers finding them and wondering what they're doing. We had to be very creative in the ways in which we approached this. So, excuse all the feelings. So Jessica, I really leaned on Tap and Hope and Jessica specifically to make this a safe space for everybody, because I don't have that particular training, although I have my own experience to lean on. I also want to thank Roanoke Public Libraries, specifically Marissa Blankenship, who provided the space for us to have classes. The libraries were a great resource because they were on a bus line. It was a great space to bring kiddos if kiddos were available. And it was very public and safe while also being private, so it filled in a lot of needs for us. And I want to thank all of our volunteers who came to class. The biggest request that I had was that volunteers come and be present, because domestic violence is a really uncomfortable issue, and a lot of people don't want to talk about it, and they don't want to touch it with a 10-foot pole, because it is not something that is easily resolved. So my request of volunteers was a very big ask, where I wanted them to come to class and not try to fix a thing, but to sit and be present and make art next to some of the most isolated residents in our community. And that's what they did. That's an uncomfortable thing, and that I am so proud of all of the people that came to help and sit with discomfort with us. Thank you for the platform to use my voice. I want to go over some of the statistics that were read today so that we can sit with them as a community. 1 in 3 women and 1 in 7 men experience intimate partner violence. Survivors are 3 times more likely to engage in self-harming behaviors. Survivors are 3 times more likely to have suicidal thoughts, 4 times more likely to attempt suicide, and 77% of survivors experience violence upon leaving their abuser. 75% experience an increase in violence for the first 2 years after leaving their abuser, with the first 18 months being the most dangerous. I would like for our community to sit with the discomfort of those statements. I would argue that domestic violence is a very layered issue, but the biggest layer I wanted to address with this project was the layer of loneliness and isolation. Nobody should have to sit with this alone. So that is what I would like for the artists in my community, the writers, the creatives, and anybody who cares, is to just continue to sit with those people in our community that are most isolated, to help provide resources, to tell them they're not alone, and to consider or ponder for a moment what can happen for a person when they create something instead of attempting suicide to get out of a bad situation. where they create something and find a friend during the darkest moments of their lives. This is something that is simple that we can offer without necessarily fixing. And that's really all I have to say about it. It was a huge opportunity. We did 8 weeks of classes. We helped, I hope, at least a few people feel less alone. And now we have this show on the first floor documenting and showing the work made by my students. So thank you to the city and for giving me this time to talk about my project.
I just wanted to say a quick thank you to Lena for putting herself in a position to be an agent of change. This project has been absolutely incredible, and it pinpointed, as a violence prevention educator for me, it pinpointed a space. There was a gap. There was a big gap, and I'm grateful that we now have developed a partnership, and TAP will continue to fund projects like this.
Thank you. Thank you. Let me, before we just ask my colleague if they have any comments.
I didn't
hear.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming forward and expressing your advocacy and expressing it in art. I do want to thank Mayor Lee, because I was in the clerk's office when he came on council and he promoted that domestic violence task force. And I also appreciate the victim witness that came forth, the grant that we've had in place for several years for victims. My parents, I grew up in domestic violence, didn't know it at the time, but that was part of the divorce. And I had a sibling who dealt with that as well. And so I know about domestic violence and what that does, and I currently serve on the Salvation Army Board for Turning Point, so I get it, and I'm an advocate for those out there who are dealing with domestic violence, and it continues to be so as a generational curse. So the more we put it out there to say there are places and resources for people to use, we are hoping that they will come forward and look for that safety place that they can call home and move forward. Thank you for the time.
Thank you. I just wanted to thank you, Lena and Jessica, for creating a space for beauty to come out of brokenness. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember
White
Boyd, if you could scoot.
Come this way?
No, I was
good.
Just.
Yep, you're good now. Okay. All right.
And show what I mean.
Yep, and everybody's good. Thank you. One, two, three. One more.
Hold on, Vivian.
One, two, three. Thank you.
Thank you.
We also have a proclamation today for National Lead Poisoning Prevention Week. Is there anybody here? All right, come on down. Hey, welcome to come. All right. Good, how you doing? How you doing? Good. Okay. All right. Whereas lead exposure to children can result from multiple sources and can cause irreversible and lifelong health effects. Whereas lead is especially dangerous to children under the age of 6. Whereas lead poisoning is preventable. The key is to keep children from coming into contact with lead. Whereas there are simple steps that can be taken to protect all family members from lead-based paint hazards in the home. And whereas education and awareness about the dangers of lead can help protect the lives of children living in the state of Virginia. Now, therefore, I, Sherman P. Lee, Sr., Mayor of the City of Roanoke, Virginia, encourage all citizens to observe this week with appropriate programs and activities designed to enhance public awareness of lead poisoning prevention and a way to protect their families from lead poisoning, and hereby proclaim October 20th through the 26th, 2024, throughout this great 8-time All-American city as National Lead Poisoning Prevention Week. And I'm pleased to ask to come on up and introduce yourself to the council and introduce the members of the group this year.
I'm Katie Kennedy. I'm the program manager for Lead Safe Roanoke, and I have our team with us. Chris Bowling is our site coordinator. He visits all of the properties and checks in on our contractors doing lead work at individual homeowners' properties. And then Liz is our intake coordinator. She makes sure that we and quickly enroll anybody who applies into our programs. And then I'm sure most of you already know Marla, but she's our education and outreach coordinator for the program. And so we actually have some really exciting news this week, too. It's Lead Poisoning Prevention Week, and we're excited that for an additional 4 years, we'll be able to continue to provide services. We received with the grant award from the federal government, from HUD, along with our matching dollars, we have $6.25 million that will continue for the next 4 years to provide services to keep kids safe in their homes.
It's the biggest and best yet. We can't wait. If there's folks out there who are worried about where they live and their kids, we're here to help. This grant can certainly help so many people, and we're happy to be here and happy to do it.
All right, thank you. Anybody else? Okay. Well, we're gonna take a picture. We'll walk right up and take this picture. Thank you.
Do amazing work. We've gotten so many awards as a city because of the work that y'all do, and this has got to be really exciting to have 6.25 million behind you. So good luck with getting rid of all that money.
We're now down to the section of hearing of citizens upon public matters. City Council sets this time as a priority for citizens to be heard. All matters will be referred to the city manager or deputy city manager for a response, recommendation, or report to council as he may he or she may deem appropriate. So, Madam Clerk, are there any people signed up?
Yes, it is. We have three speakers.
Can you call them in order that they signed up?
Yes, please? I will. The first speaker will be Frida Cathcart, followed by Barbara Dirk, and then Nathan Harper.
I'm short. I'm Frida Cathcart. I signed up online as District Director Frida Cathcart. Sometimes I come where I am in an official position, and when I do so, I'd really appreciate to be called up that way. I wanted to make you all aware about a potential Roanoke gas rate increase of 5%. That's actually different than my position on the Soil and Water Conservation Board, but I just did want to take a few seconds to flag that for you, because the deadline in order to testify for that hearing, I believe, is October 30th for the SCC. This is really important because a lot of the buildings that Roanoke City funds with utilities is through Roanoke Gas, so that will affect the heating costs for your budget. And I just got an email today about where you all are looking at the budget and how it's in alignment. This is the second time that Roanoke Gas has tried to pass along the cost of the Mountain Valley Pipeline to the people of Roanoke. There are two other pipelines that serve this area that provides us gas that's cheaper and not as expensive as Mountain Valley. And I think the city has a good case to be able to say, please give us the cheap gas. We don't need your expensive gas. And I can follow up later with information about that, because I am an energy investor and I will be testifying at that event. But that is separate than my responsibilities as the Soil and Water Conservation Board. What I really wanted to bring to your attention today was wanting to have a better and more symbiotic relationship with the Roanoke City staff. You all that were here 2 years ago might recall where I did a PowerPoint presentation about the floodplains, Lick Run and Murray Run, and about the flood resiliency and the importance of having a plan. That's really important to have a plan, because the board that I serve on is responsible for getting state and federal funds that funnels directly through our board and out to on the ground. Another aspect of the position that I'm in is going to conferences and listening to our partners every month, which is the Forest Service, the USDA, the Department of Conservation and Recreation, the DEQ, and I'm probably forgetting some others, that give us reports about opportunities that are coming up, whether it's going directly through our board or just to let our localities know of these opportunities. So I do the best that I can in order to make sure that that happens. So I'm kind of like the reverse of you all, where you have problems in search of money. We have money in search of problems. So we want to try and connect those two together as quickly as possible. I last week attended a meeting down at our board in our office, where we are donating our staff to help coordinate a regional flood resiliency plan. I'm proud to say that Roanoke City was the only locality that has a flood resiliency plan that was done in 2022, which is great. That puts us in position to get potentially $7.5 million each year to help us with flood resiliency plans. Now, where can that make a difference? I was just looking at the Lick Run watershed plan. Back in 2017, a report was done showing that it would cost $47 million at that time to repair that stream to bring it up to DEQ requirements. That's on the backs of Roanoke City. So that's really important that the staff, the planning commission, everybody understands about flood resiliency and how it coordinates and the opportunities that come up, because we want to get this free money coming from the federal and state government to get on the ground, so we're not coming to the citizens of Roanoke to get that $47 million to repair that stream. Okay. So I really wanted to encourage you and everybody else to go for a walk in the near future in the woods and to make sure that you all understand the urgency of the situation that we are in. Recently, there's an article published and The Guardian that said that disruptions to the water cycle already causing suffering. Nearly 3 billion people face water scarcity, crops are shriveling, and cities are sinking as the groundwater beneath them dries. I'm sorry, that was the wrong one that I was trying to read. If this keeps going down on me. The report is that trees and land absorbed almost no carbon dioxide last year. And if you go for a walk in the woods, you will notice the shift where usually like there's like a moistness and a smell of earthiness. It's dried up. Go. Check it out. It's different. It's dusty. So that carbon sink's not there anymore. And I wanted to alert you that because the climate, the EPA grant that was applied for has to do with suffering from heat resiliency, and there's a grant application I'm currently working on with nonprofits that will help to turn it around so we don't have that heat island effect. We have to do that work now. It is dire. You all have passed it. You have plans. We need to implement. We all need to work together to have that happen. So I appreciate your time today, and I will be following up. Thank you.
And Mr. Mayor, over here.
Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to comment on a comment that Ms. Cathcart made at the last council meeting, I believe, about grant funding, and it was referred to the manager that dealt with some funding for the Gainsborough area, and I believe she's working on a grant, and the city's working with her on it, that will bring grant funding to the Gainsborough community. So I hope the city will look at that with her and apply for that grant money, as she say, free money that's out there. So if you'd like to speak on that, if she could, Mr. Mayor, yeah. I would like to.
I appreciate that because one of the ways that we have to prove that we're able to get this money is not just to have a plan, but to make sure that the projects are shovel ready. And there's just a few of them that regards like potentially rezoning and some mitigation that needs to be done. Just like under $100,000 that could result in millions of dollars coming to us. So it's a great return on the investment. Yes. And I know it's hard, but we have to like fly the plane while we're building it. We all need to work together. So yes. Thank you for mentioning that.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. And I'm always pleased to hear that we have money that's looking for a problem.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
This has gotten higher. Mayor, members of City Council, I am delighted to be here today. I am Barbara Dirk. I'm talking on two issues. One, give honor and glory. This is the first day of the rest of your life. And this weekend was absolutely fantastic. I saw many of you at GoFest. I saw some of you at the Crop Walk. And then there was the Violence and Blue workshop on Sunday afternoon, too. I have heard wonderful, wonderful things about the temporary protected bike lane that was on Jefferson Street from Elm Avenue to Starbucks at BTC. People loved it. They said, oh, I feel so good about riding my bike and I feel so protected. So I wanted to let you know what I'm hearing about bicycle accommodations and the improvements that we're making to make bicycles feel like they're welcome in our city. That you can Google anything, and artificial intelligence that says Virginia laws apply to cars and bike lanes. Don't park in bike lanes. It's illegal to park in a bike lane. Don't drive in bike lanes. Motorists should not drive in bike lanes. Pass with caution, and we have a 3-foot law here in Virginia. Don't cross into bike lanes. Motorists cannot cross a solid line. And when you're parking as a motor vehicle, check to make sure that there's not a bicycle coming in the bike lane before you open your door. You can cross yellow lines to pass bicycles. And if artificial intelligence doesn't tell you everything that you want to know, you can go to the General Assembly Legislative Information Services, and they will tell you about riding at night, tell you about the lights that are needed, about what communities need to wear helmets, and that bicycles should not travel between two lanes of traffic going the same direction. So I would like, as a member of the Virginia Bicycling Federation board to tell you about the bicycle laws that are on the books right now and what we're proposing to make bicycling friendly in the Roanoke Valley. So, I'm going to change hats because I used to be president of the YWCA, the Young Women's Christian Association. I sent an email to clerk and asked her to distribute it to you and to members of council. The YWCA, which is no longer in existence in the city of Roanoke, but it is nationally, a main headquarters is on First Street, and now it's boarded up. But it consisted of rooms for women that came to the city, a lobby, an area, a check-in, and that might be a place for unsheltered people to live. Again, it's right here on First Street. The YWCA's one imperative was the elimination of racism. The YWCA used to own the building at Gainsborough and Melrose that's now houses the YMCA. Roanoke is recognized as a welcoming city. We need to be inclusive of everyone that is in this city. We have Latinos, you were at Local Colors. You saw how many different communities that we have living in Roanoke. So I encourage you to continue being a welcoming city. That I have two things right at the very end. The future is not a matter of chance. The future is a matter of choice. The future is not something to be wished for, but something to be achieved. And each one of you on City Council have worked very hard to make this city inclusive. Keep going. Together we can. Thank you.
And Mr. Mayor, let me, if I could, your email you sent to us about the Y on Orange Avenue in Gainsborough, as you know, I saw the response from Jonathan Pate, who said he would be reaching out to you to discuss. We talked about the mural, I believe. You were concerned that it did not represent the women that once was at the Y. It only showed what the Y MCA is now. So I hope they'll come together and allow you an opportunity to be heard and to perhaps look at the mural and where we can incorporate the women on that mural.
Miss Moon Reynolds, it's more than that. I gave the first email that I wrote to the female members of City Council, and that should have been in your box. But I'm more concerned than that. That I, in the second email, I told about a Love Thy Neighbor walk that I have done in the communities, and I'm seeing a transition. Roanoke used to have Northwest as the most segregated city, and that's how what we were known for. That is not true anymore. Right. And it's not that I don't think it's true. It is not true anymore. That we are a much more inclusive, welcoming city. And that any of our gateways, any art that we put out today needs to reflect that we are one. And the city motto, the city, what do you call it, Chris? The city of Roanoke is a safe, caring, and economically vibrant community in which to live, learn, work, play, and prosper. A vibrant urban city with strong neighborhoods set amongst the spectacular beauty of Virginia's Blue Ridge. So I would appreciate if you'll have a chance to read my other email that came in sometime today and help me figure out how to make this a positive learning experience of where we've been, where we are, and where we want to be.
Yes.
Thank you.
No, thank you. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Mayor, Vice Mayor, and other members of City Councils and others in the room. My name is Nathan Harper. I've been a proud resident here of Roanoke City for 18 years, and I think probably one of the bigger cheerleaders of the city throughout those 18 years. It's where I decided to call home, to raise a family. My kids are in Roanoke City Schools, to operate a business, et cetera. So I'm all in. And in those 18 years, it's the first time I've come to speak with you all, as a citizen. I am with Spectrum Design. We are architects and engineers downtown in Roanoke, and we've had the good fortune and pleasure of being a part of many of the city's wonderful structures that have been enhanced or put up over the years. We're very proud of that, and we really appreciate that partnership. Our office is located at 10 Church Avenue Southeast. This is right adjacent to Century Plaza. And if you're familiar with that area, it's with the tall ginkgo trees. It's one of the most beautiful places in the city, very photographed, especially this time of year in the fall. This beautiful space really was once a great asset for our office. However, over the years, it's become more of a liability. The days of school children over at Center in the Square eating their lunch and congregating have turned into quite a different scene on a regular basis in Century Plaza. I know this is all very complex. It's a public park, et cetera, and I do think that everyone has a right to be there. But the public safety concerns are growing. This came to a head a few weeks ago. One of the tenants in our building, an employee there, was physically assaulted in broad daylight on their way to the office. And so because of that, that sort of prompted me to come and just speak to you all to raise awareness about the need to keep an eye on that space. From a property perspective, we have lost a handful of tenants over in recent years. There's actually one moving out as we speak, packing their bags. Some of them are going further out within the city, but they're all getting out of downtown. And I think larger office buildings that have their own security presence, et cetera, it's maybe not as big of a deal, but for smaller buildings like ours, it is a challenge. And that's lost revenue. It's lost businesses within the downtown. So I just want to raise awareness about this today and ask that you continue to support initiatives to enhance patrols through that area. I also really support the ambassador program and what that has done downtown. I think it's doing great things. And I don't have a magic solution for you, and I know that you have a lot on your plate. I'm not really sure if there's anything more that can be done, but I encourage you to look for opportunities to continue to make our downtown a safe and vibrant place. This really is the heart and the epicenter of our entire region from arts, culture, and business perspective, and you've heard from a lot of folks today about the wonderful and rich things that are going on here. So really appreciate your time today, and just ask that you continue to invest in the downtown and making a safe place for all. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was the last speaker, Mayor.
All right, thank you. And that really concludes all of our citizens who want to discuss public matters. The next on our agenda is the consent agenda. All matters listed under the consent agenda are considered to be routine by members of City Council and will be enacted by one motion. There will be no separate discussions of the item. If discussion is desired, the item will be removed from the consent agenda and considered separately. And I want to call your attention to a request for a closed meeting from our city attorney, Mr. Tim Spencer, to convene in a closed meeting for a consultation with legal counsel regarding specific legal matters where such consultation or briefing in an open meeting would adversely affect the discussion or consideration of the investment of public funds where competition or bargaining is involved, where if made public initially, the financial interest of the city would be adversely affected. Pursuant to Section 2.2-3711 Code of Virginia, as amended, I need a motion for approval.
Move the consent agenda.
Second.
All right, Madam Clerk, could you please call the roll?
Yes, Ms. White Boyd.
Aye.
Mr. Volleson.
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb.
Aye.
And Mayor Lee.
Aye, and the consent agenda is approved. Thank you. All right, we now move to our regular agenda. Item 6-5, public hearings, we have none. Item 6 is petitions and communications, we have none. And item number 7 is reports of city officers. 7-1 is interim city manager briefings. So I'll call on Mr. Deputy City Manager Romans to introduce the briefing.
Yes, thank you, Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of the council. Today we have two presentations prepared for you. The first of which is Ms. Lindsay. Ms. Lindsay will present you with the August 2024 monthly financial and budget report. And as she comes to the podium, we are all filled with joy and just elated because we've already started the budget process. And we've been engaged in several meetings associated with the budget process. Ms. Lindsay?
Thank you, Mayor Lee, Vice Mayor Cobb, members of council, Mr. Roman. We have your September numbers for you today, and I do want to apologize on the cover. I do know it is not 2023, but my editing skills failed me on that one, so we will have that corrected.
Lovely picture, though.
As always, we start off with revenues, one of my most favorite things. And as you can see with our real estate tax and just the timing of the report, the October 5th, October 6th deadline, we do have the bulk of collections in for that. There certainly were some that will roll in October, so that number will grow. And certainly any mail that had to be processed will add to that as well. It takes more than just a day or two with the volume that I know the Treasurer's Office has. I do want to point out that all of our year-end fiscal 24 accruals, anything that belonged in fiscal 24 has come out of 25 and been placed in 24. So we feel very comfortable saying that we have the dollars in the correct year. I'm sure there's $10 out there somewhere that should have gone in 24, but we've stopped looking for that $10 and we're moving on. I do want to point out one to me that looks very different year over year. It was called to my attention earlier this morning also. Prepared food and beverage in fiscal year 24 was coming in at $3.3 million, whereas same time a year later at $2.582 million. The finance department does not have and should not have details of who pays what or who maybe hasn't paid yet. So we'll be making an inquiry of the Commissioner of Revenue's office and certainly can convey more information when we have that. I did go back and wanted to be sure that somehow we had not picked up something, but these are exactly reflective of our general ledger when the reports were pulled. Which I did also just want to comment, if I'll go into the ledger today and look at any of the numbers, they will likely be different to have proper cutoff. The report was generated about October 10th or 12th. So we have a little bit of lag from when we prepare the information to today presenting it. That's going to be the same every month, so we will catch up as we go through the year. I have one other item. I know that down in our non-local tax items, we have several numbers that are very similar. And so I felt certain I had done something again incorrectly, but they're not. I'm fascinated that fines and forfeitures are barely $150 different year over year, but that is correct. And I did also want to just comment, Grants and Aid Commonwealth is very likely a timing issue of when reimbursements are sought for state grants or just the timing of when the Commonwealth sends us money. Again, nothing isn't there that we would expect to be there. And on over to expenditures. Again, one of the things I look at most closely is the percent of budget. At 3 months, you would be at around 25%, and we are either just a little less than that or slightly more, for example, in community development, and that may well be for those entities that we provide support for. We provide all of their support in one payment, and so that can skew timing. Some items, of course, pay overtime more ratably than others. So nothing of any great strangeness or interest to point out of in expenditures. I did want to just mention that in the coming months, it may not be next month, but certainly very soon, I want to be able to take each of the different categories we see here, and there will be an additional slide that says, okay, what makes up public works? What are the exact departments? And they will present just the same as what is here. It'll just be a longer list. And I didn't want to do every single one of those at one time. That's a lot of information, and it may dilute what we want to just be able to show a little more detail. That may engender questions, and that would be great, but that is on the plate coming down the road. I'm happy to answer any questions or take notes and go back and find good answers as well.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Thank you. I was looking at your permits, your fees, and your services. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at what was actually spent year-to-date and compared to what we have received now at actual. And I think it's close to half. And I just want to know, is that
on the revenue?
Yes, on the revenue side, yes, ma'am, under permits and fees.
I agree. I'll need to go back and look and see if there was some big something in 23. In 24 that has not repeated.
Right.
And I will pass that along to Mr. Roman. He can share out to council.
And also looking at your miscellaneous revenue. I think that's where we receive money, and I see similar with that as well, where last year it's almost like pretty much
absolutely.
Half. So I'm just curious about that as well, since we trend in less.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
Anyone else?
No, that was great. Mark,
thank you for the
excellent
report.
Job breaking it down
yes.
for us.
Appreciate that.
Thank you.
Very
yes.
thorough.
Mayor, Vice Mayor, and members of council, Mrs. Bohr, she will present you with a brief presentation on the purpose of metrics in a local government, an example of how we use metrics, and an overview of dashboards and how they can be used.
Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of council, Deputy City Manager Roman. So I'm Vanessa Bohr. For those of you that don't know me, I'm the Chief Information Officer for the city. I also have with me Jared Anthony. He is an IT manager in the applications division over community and GIS systems. So Councilman Volison approached us about the possibility of having kind of a health of a city dashboard to kind of show how our city is doing performance-wise. After doing some research, a lot of localities are calling this a city performance dashboard. So we're here to present the importance of that and go over some examples. So metrics play a key role in measuring organizational performance. Metrics allow for transparency to provide insights on how we're doing performance. They also ensure accountability by tracking progress and ensuring that we meet our goals. It holds us responsible for delivering results. Metrics are key for informed decision making. Data-driven decisions allow us to utilize resources effectively and adapt to challenges based on facts. Finally, they allow us to continuously improve. By regularly updating our metrics, we identify areas for growth and optimize our services. All departments currently use performance measures. Some of these can be found in the city's strategic plan. There's a section in the annual budget document and various department reports. On the screen, you'll see a sample out of the annual budget document, and this is from related to street maintenance. Other examples include things like tracking our expenditures to our budget, kind of like the presentation Ms. Lindsay just put on. For public safety, it can include things like emergency response times and crime rates. So now we're talking about taking these performance measures and putting them on a dashboard. So what exactly is a dashboard? It's a digital platform that displays data either real-time or updated periodically. It's meant to be visual. It's meant to be user-friendly. Typically, they're interactive and accessible. They allow you to explore the data and get additional details. Dashboards are customizable, so we can display the metrics that you all choose from the different departments. We can provide additional information to explain the metric and the trends that we're seeing. So the tool that we would be proposing using is an ESRI tool, and this is because we're already licensed for this tool. We have data in the product already, so the real estate GIS site that's running, all that data is in this back-end system. We also have familiarity with our staff, so the main resource that this would require is really staff time. We can display different data, including from city systems, so that might include the public safety systems, like the police records management system or the 911 system. We can also pull financial data or permit data. These are just kind of a sample of city data that we can pull. It's not a whole list. Those can be updated more regularly because we have access to those. We can also include things like state and federal data, so census data is easily accessible in the tool. We can also access data from the state and download it and upload it into this tool, which can include things like the Virginia Department of Social Services data that's referenced in the budget performance metric. We can also include other entities if that's desired. So if the Roanoke City Public Schools or the Water Authority have data that we want to kind of show as a collective, we can also upload that data and periodically update it as reports come out. We do kind of recommend starting with city systems and census data only because it's already accessible until we can get some of the metrics going. So we're going to show a few examples from other cities. And right here is a screenshot. So ESRI provides a template that you can use and start populating your own data. So one of the localities is using this template, and another one has where you can deep dive into the metrics a little bit more. So I'm going to hand it off to Jared Anthony to do those demos.
Thank you. So we're going to look at two different localities today. Like I said, there are many localities that use this. If you want to see any other examples, please reach out to us, and we'll be happy to provide those. So we're actually going to take a tour of the southwestern part of the country. I didn't expect me to struggle with technologies as part of the technology offer. Thank you. Appreciate it, Amy. Okay, so like I said, we'll start with a tour of the southwestern part of the country. We'll take a look at Arlington, Texas. Their dashboard is called Your City at Work. And they have several different priorities. I'm just going to briefly scroll through these so you get an idea, and then we'll click on one or two. They've got Champion, Great Neighborhoods, support youth and families, invest in our economy, enhance regional mobility, leverage technology, build unity, poor services. So let's go to the top and do champion great neighborhoods. So you'll see they have several different tiles. This particular locality is big on volunteer hours. So for example, you may see park volunteer hours. If you notice red, that's a quick indication to the viewer that this is below their goal. In this particular case, it'd be below 30,000. Green, quick indication you're meeting the goal. Blue is, you know, they're measuring it. So library visitors, for example, they've got, you know, 541,000. And you can also look at the history of, like, the Neighborhood Quality Life Survey. You can see its history. They do this each year, so you can kind of get an idea of the trend. And also as nice is, you can, if you want to say, okay, animal service volunteer hours, what is that about? You can go to the detail tab, and it will show you a little more information about that priority. The next one we have is Tempe, Arizona, and they've got 5 strategic priorities, and they have them laid out here. I know we've got 7, and that's, I kind of envision us doing something similar to this, but with 7 priorities. The first one, safe and secure communities. And they have a lot of metrics on this. I was going to click on the first one, fire response time. And so this particular case, you know, looking at their calls of ALS, you know, advanced life support calls, you respond to within 6 minutes or less. So you can easily see, okay, they've got 60.8%, which is, you know, it's in red, it's below their target of 90%. So I know Chief Hoback comes, presents front of council, does a really good job of giving out these statistics. And you can maybe say something like this is what, you know, we could easily show on these dashboards. And if you click on it, you can get a little bit more information of the history of that target, and as well as a little more definition of what this measure is, why it's important. And they also have at the bottom some strategies in terms of how they want to meet these metrics. I'll just click on one more real quick for you guys. Go back out to the main screen, go to sustainable growth and development. And go to housing inventory ratio. I know, you know, like a lot of cities, you know, housing inventory, affordable housing is a big topic here in Roanoke. So like I said, once again, here easily to see, they set their goals, and like a lot of places, you know, it looks like they're, it's a struggle to reach their goals for housing. So like I said, it's a really good, these dashboards, really good, easy place to consolidate data, make it usable to citizens as well as council. And just for example, speaking like the housing area, you know, one of the topics been a lot of discussion is zoning changes in the city of Roanoke. What impact will those have? You know, the housing, you know, units. Perhaps that's one thing that can be measured. You know, where the units of the zoning changes have appeared and in what neighborhoods. Might have something interested for you guys to track. So I just want to conclude with, you know, thanking council and Deputy City Manager Roman for advice to speak today, and I just really want to say I thank these dashboards. We really work with you guys. Look forward to doing that to really tell the story of our great 8-time All-American city. So appreciate your time today. Yes. Any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to call on Ms. Trish Whiteboard. She has a question.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have a couple questions. I want to start with you, Mr. Anthony. So the data that you have, is it coming from systems that are already integrated? Nobody's having to input this, right? So it's interfaced somehow so that you can retrieve this data to compile it the way it is coming to us?
Sure. In these particular examples of localities, I'm assuming these are data they generated themselves as opposed to, like, the federally data, like the census. So well, we have several different data sets now, public safety being one of them, permits being another, different budget information, financial information. Those data we already currently have, it's the way Vanessa had one of the slides, you know, just an example of either metrics, we're already kind of capturing them. It's a matter of just kind of consolidating them, getting them into a format that's easily accessible to you and the citizens.
Right. So as long as a department is already inputting it into their system, we would not have them enter it again.
Right, right.
We would pull it out of the back end of a system.
So as long as it's there already, you
yes.
can just kind of compile it and,
yes.
and put, okay, that is wonderful. Now, the other question that I have is, where would you find it? Where are you going to find this information, and who would have access to it? You just said the citizens, everybody, anybody who wanted this information would have access to it.
It's what kind of, in terms of, we'd work with you guys, city leadership
to determine that?
Pick out which data you'd like to see on this dashboard. Some dashboard, like the one we're looking at today, is public facing. But I know other cities, they have, you know, internal facing, just, you know, for city employees, council. So we'd work with you guys, city leadership, to display the data, specific data you'd like to see.
Okay, so you would get kind of a poll or general consensus from council and admin to see what
what we're actually looking for? Because that's pretty complex. That's a lot of stuff.
It is. It's,
yes. I mean, again, that's why we kind of reference some of the things that we're already tracking. So, like, in the city strategic plan or in the in the budget document, looking at those as examples would be a good start, because the department's already reporting on it. It's definitely data that they already have, and it's what they're measuring themselves against. So that would be kind of a starting point instead of just trying to pick.
I think it's great, and I certainly commend Mr. Volleson for bringing it to your attention. In fact, I know he's talked about it quite a bit, but I didn't think that you would be bringing us something that quickly. I think we are amazing, this eight-time All-America city. So thank you, and thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Any other? Mr. Sanchez, on? Well, I saw you first. Go ahead. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead, Mia. I just want to know who will be managing the dashboard? Which department? Is it your department that will be managing it?
Yes, it will be our department. We could work with the other departments if they wanted to include additional information or things like that.
And the cost?
So we are already licensed for this product. That's kind of why we chose this, is it's our back-end GIS software license. We can already put dashboards up now if we choose to. So it's really just going to be kind of the resource time of taking the employees' time to pull the data and put it onto the dashboard.
Thank you.
Ms. Walsh, I'm coming back.
Sure, I just had a question. I know Peter's biting at the bit, so I'm not going to hold him, because this is. Yeah, let everybody answer, and then Peter can have it. Yes. I do want to thank you all for the transparency, because you know I'm an advocate for transparency and accountability. What I do have a question is, and it was, and I think I just read about it, is the fact that it's coming now. It didn't come on before when it could have, and so I thank Peter for that. Much, but one of my questions is, I see you're using three localities, but you don't have any in Virginia. Is there any localities in the Commonwealth that is using this type of metrics in their local government interface on their websites?
Yes, I believe Fairfax or Loudoun County use it. I just recently learned today, I haven't checked out myself, Williamsburg also has something similar. These particular ones highlighted, we want to really show you some of the ones that have been getting a lot of the awards nationwide. Mm-hmm. So that's why I brought those to you today.
Right. I'm always interested in what Virginia is doing, so that before one says Roanoke is first, I just wanted to find out if others were already ahead of us and is already putting that in place. So I'll go out to Williamsburg, you said, and
yes,
Arlington?
Williamsburg, I believe Fairfax and Loudoun County.
Because I like to see what they have on their page as well.
Exactly. We really like to see what Virginia, other localities.
Yeah, because I think it's more interesting to see what the Commonwealth is doing, since it's on Southwest Virginia side or up in Northern Virginia. That helps me. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Peter.
I agree that that makes it so that we can compare ourselves with our neighbors.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. I just want to thank you, Vanessa, and your staff for putting this together. I think that this is a great tool. It's very transparent. So when people ask us, you know, hey, what's going on with this, they can go and look at it right on the website, and they get the same information that we do. So I really, right now, I thank you again for coming up with a set of initial metrics that we might be able to use. These are based off of data that we currently have. And that's what's so great about it. We have this data just sitting around, and now it's time we can actually look at it, use it, and make sure that our public can see it. So I just wanted to thank you and thank the council in advance for your work on what will be our dashboard and what metrics we'd like to see up there.
Did you give us that deadline?
November 1st is your deadline.
November 1st.
Thank
you. I knew that.
Thanks for putting it out there.
Yeah.
Thank you.
No, thank you.
All right. That's it. Thank you all. Thank you.
Those are all of our presentations.
Okay, thank you. All right, we're now going to move to items which are recommended for action. Item 7.1A is approval of a letter agreement for student parking spaces with Roanoke Higher Education Center and Park Roanoke Higher Education Lot. There is a resolution.
Move the resolution.
Second.
Madam Clerk, could you please read the title paragraph?
A resolution approving the terms of a letter agreement between the City of Roanoke, Virginia, and Roanoke Higher Education Center for access to parking spaces for the students attending the Roanoke Higher Education Center at the higher ed parking lot, authorizing the city manager or her designee to execute the letter agreement referred to above, and authorizing the city manager or her designee to execute such other documents and to take such further actions as may be necessary to implement, administer, and enforce such letter agreement.
All right, thank you. I know that Brian is here. Brian, is there any comments or any thoughts you need to make on it?
Thank you, Mayor Lee, Vice Mayor Cobb, members of council, Deputy Manager Roman. This is just a simple letter agreement that we're going to rent spaces to the higher ed for $20 a space. That's really it. It's for student parking, and we're just showing our, you know, availability to help them out.
Thank you. All right. Any further discussion?
I just want, Mayor, if I could, just to make sure the public understands that this is not the space that Ms. Dunkley came to speak about. This is the space at the Higher Ed Center across, I think it's right across from
the parking lot,
the surface lot that across from them. So they won't think we've moved ahead on that action. Thank you.
All right. Madam Clerk, I guess we're ready to vote. Please call the roll.
Ms. White Boyd.
Aye.
Mr. Volleson.
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb.
Aye.
Mayor Lee.
Aye. And the resolution passes. Thank you. Item B is adoption of the City of Roanoke's Title for Implementation Plan. There's a resolution.
Move the resolution.
Second.
All right. Madam Clerk, please read the title paragraph.
A resolution approving and adopting the City of Roanoke's Title VI Implementation Plan. I believe Mayor said four. It is six.
Yes.
Six.
All right. Any discussion? All right. Hearing none. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Ms. White Boyd.
Aye.
Mr. Volleson.
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb.
Aye.
Mayor Lee.
Aye. And the resolution passes. Thank you.
And Mayor, if I could have an editorial comment on this.
Yes, sir.
Angela Vernon put in a great deal of work on this, a lot of detail, took a lot of time, and did a wonderful job on it. Thank you for that at that time.
All right, Angela, you got anything you want to share with us, Angela, on your work on?
Certainly want to thank the city attorney, but Mayor, Vice Mayor Cobb, and members of council, we are pleased to share with you that we did receive approval on our Title VI plan from the Virginia Department of Transportation Salem District Civil Rights Office, and we received that on September the 26th of 2024. This process did start in 2022, so it has been a little bit of a journey, and you may recall in 2022 you approved a designation of our Director of Human Resources as our LPA, Local Public Agency, Title VI Coordinator, and that is Mr. Chris Parker, who's with us this afternoon. So certainly we want to thank the City Attorney's Office for their support, as well as our Director of Public Works, Mr. Ross Campbell, our City Engineer, Luke Pugh, who was just an invaluable resource, and all our members within the Public Works Division. So we're just pleased to be able to share with you that we do have approval. And I will also share with you that the Virginia Department of Transportation's Civil Rights Division did select the City of Roanoke to pilot their automation tool. So we're very excited about that. There's a yearly annual report that we will have to provide, and we will be an external tester. Mr. Parker's going to lead that effort on behalf of the city, and then we'll be up for renewal within 3 years from this time frame. So in 2027, we'll have to go back through a very similar process. So thank you.
Mm-hmm. You have it down pat now, so it won't be
easy. Okay. Okay, yes, ma'am.
Next time, you will easy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Clerk, where were we? Could we read the poll?
On item C now, we're going to item C.
Okay, so the resolution passes. So item C is the execution of the citywide bridge maintenance drift removal contract modification. There's a resolution.
Move the resolution. Second.
All right, Madam Clerk, could you please read the title paragraph?
A resolution authorizing the city manager's issuance of a change order to the city's contract with Holt, Inc. for changes in connection with the work on the citywide bridge maintenance draft removal contract.
All right, any discussion by members of council? Hearing none, Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Ms. Whiteboy.
Aye.
Mr. Volleson.
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb.
Aye.
And Mayor Lee.
Aye, and the resolution passes. Item D is the Virginia Department of Housing and Community Development, Virginia's Homeless Solutions Program, which is VHSP grant award. There are two measures. The first is a resolution.
Move the resolution.
Second.
Madam Clerk, can you read the title paragraph?
A resolution accepting the Virginia Department of Housing and Community Development Virginia Homeless Solutions Program grant award to the city for continuum of care strategies and homeless services and prevention programs, and authorizing execution of any required documents on behalf of the city.
All right. Any discussion? Is anybody here to talk about this so the public can know what we're doing? Who is that?
Yes, Ms. Coleman.
Oh, Matt. Matt, could you share with us, for at least our public, some understanding of what this matter will entail?
Good afternoon, Mayor Lee, Vice Mayor Cobb, members of council. So this is our Virginia Homeless Solutions Program. It's our primary state funding that we use to respond to homelessness through our continuum of care partners. So it funds for the city a staff position for our coordinated entry program. And then we contract planning services with the Council of Community Services. I think they're a part of the resolution. And then more broadly in the community, we also receive prevention funds, rapid rehousing funds, HOPWA funds, HMIS funds that help us just respond to homelessness in the community. So state funds that we receive every year from DHCD.
Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. Matt, could you talk briefly about the coordinated entry system and how that works in the community?
Sure, yeah. So we have a coordinated entry system where everyone that comes into our homeless services system gets assessed with a common assessment tool. They get placed on a community queue, and then we have case conferencing committees that go through our community queue and match individuals to housing resources based on their score on that common assessment tool and what their needs are. So it's just a comprehensive way for us to really assess everyone that's in our system and match them with resources to meet their needs.
Thank you.
And these funds staff pay for a staff position to help us coordinate that system.
That's great. Thank you. Anybody questions? Madam Clerk, I think we're ready to vote on it.
All right. Ms. Whiteboy.
Aye.
Mr. Volleson.
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb.
Aye.
And Mayor Lee.
Aye. And the resolution passes. There's a budget ordinance.
Move the budget ordinance.
Second.
Madam Clerk, can you read the title paragraph, please?
Yes. An ordinance to appropriate funding from the Commonwealth of Virginia of Community Development for the Virginia Homeless Solutions Program, amending and reordaining certain sections of the 2024-2025 grant fund appropriations, and dispensing with the second reading by title of this ordinance.
Thank you. Any discussion by members of council? Hearing none, Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Ms. Whiteboy.
Aye.
Mr. Volleson.
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb.
Aye.
Mayor Lee.
Aye. And the budget ordinance passes. Thank you. Item E is accept and appropriate allocations of funding from the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. There are two measures. One is a resolution.
Move the resolution.
Second.
Madam Clerk, please read the title paragraph.
A resolution accepting certain entitlement funding from the United States Department of Housing and Urban Development to be used according to the City of Roanoke's 2024 HUD Annual Plan Update to the City's 2020 through 2024 Consolidated Plan, authorizing the interim city manager or the interim city manager's designee to execute all necessary documents pertaining thereto, and further authorizing the interim city manager or the city manager's designee to submit such plan to the United States Department of Housing and Urban Development for final review and approval.
All right. Any discussion? Vice Mayor.
Matt, I was going to have you stay up here. I had one more question on this. The question is basically, I know that we've found in recent years that we're trying to do more with less with federal funding. Can you talk a little bit about what our challenges are related to, it seems like federal funding for the HUD has been pretty flat. And so we're continuing to get funding, which is great, but considering some of our local challenges, it's making us be more creative and thoughtful in how we utilize funds that aren't increasing.
Sure, yeah, and I think these are actually the entitlement funds that flow through our Community Resources Division, but yeah, for sure, the federal funds that we have are extremely limited compared to the need in the community, especially related to homeless response and the ESG money that flows through Katie's office. So unfortunately, we're limited on what the federal government allocates for homeless services and block grant funds. So more funds are always needed for sure, but we try to stretch what we have to the best of our ability to meet the need, but it's a drop in the bucket, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. One reason, and I thank the Vice Mayor for the question, is we want the public to understand. I mean, we get this material go over, but the John Q. public follow this? And I would hope that we would break that down in such terms that they'd understand, okay, what's happening and how can we become eligible for it, or what's the issue, or what are our chances, those kinds of things. Any further thoughts you have on that? But thank you.
Yeah, so these are all entitlement funds that are appropriated by Congress. So these are set by the federal government based on a formula. So it's unfortunately relatively limited based on what we need. So we need more.
Yeah, I was wondering how they got that number. It's based on a formula?
Yep, it's a formula base. So it's based, I think, on census data and poverty rates and
different
it's
things.
A complicated formula
yeah.
that they
yeah,
use
I'm sure
to
a lot
allocate
of variables.
Funds to localities.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. All right, any further discussion? I'll ask the clerk to call the roll.
Ms. White Boyd.
Aye.
Mr. Volleson.
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb.
Aye.
And Mayor Lee.
Aye. And the resolution passes. There's a budget ordinance.
Budget ordinance.
Second.
Madam Clerk, could you please read the title paragraph?
Yes. An ordinance to appropriate funding from the Department of Housing and Urban Development for the Community Development Block Grant Program, Home Investment Partnerships Program, and Emergency Solutions Grant, amending and reordaining certain sections of the 2024-2025 grant fund appropriations and dispensing with the second reading by title of this ordinance.
Thank you. Any discussion by members of council? Hearing none, Madam Clerk, call the roll, please.
Ms. White Boyd.
Aye.
Mr. Volleson.
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds.
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb.
Aye.
And Mayor Lee.
Aye. And the budget ordinance passes. All right, I'm pleased to recognize the Deputy City Manager for any further comments that he may have.
Thank you, Mayor. I do have a few comments as well as updates. I'll start with 339 Salem Avenue Southwest. It's a future development opportunity. Please allow me to share with you information regarding a future development opportunity. Economic development staff have posted to their website a development opportunity at 339 Salem Avenue Southwest. This site formerly housed the city's homeless assistance team before its move further downtown last year. The city previously entered a contract with a developer for the development of 80 affordable housing apartment units. This posting is the result of inquiries from the development community to purchase or lease the property. Redevelopment of this site complements the extensive development that has occurred in the west end of downtown. The deadline to submit proposals is November the 15th, 2024. The next update is HomeSafe program. The HomeSafe program has formalized a grant agreement with the Belmont Lofts to develop 14 units that meet HUD's fair market rent standards. These units will be available to individuals enrolled in permanent supportive housing through the Commonwealth Catholic Charities and Blue Ridge Behavioral Health Care. In addition, HomeSafe has effectively combined the city's ARPA funds with home ARP funds to address the urgent need for affordable housing for those experiencing homelessness. Last year, 50 individuals with housing vouchers were unable to utilize them due to critical shortage of available HUD fair market rent units. Recently, the city toured the nearly completed units with supportive services staff, and prospective tenants will have the opportunity to tour in the coming weeks, with move-ins expected to start as early as November 1st. Belmont Lofts, located at 825 Stewart Avenue Southeast, will consist of a total of 32 units, including 14 designated for HomeSafe participants and 14 households for earning 60% or less of the area median income. Next update or comment is Rivers Edge North Deferred Maintenance Project. Construction has begun on a new multi-use path located around Rivers Edge North Sports Field, connecting the pedestrian bridge to the Magnolia Alley. This path will allow for a continuous interior walking loop around the warm season turf fields. Also included in this project is a restriping of the parking lot and the crosswalks on Reserve Avenue. Have a Washington Park pool update. National Pools has successfully completed pouring the bottom of the Washington Park pool. Over the next few days, they will begin the gunite operations on the sides of the pool. This process involves applying a dry mixed concrete mixture through a hose using compressed air and water, ensuring a strong and durable structure for our community. Staff will continue to monitor progress and provide further updates as the project advances. And last but not least, I sort of have a competing internal sentiment here as it relates to Director Chris Chittum. Director Chris Chittum will be moving on. He has decided to retire after 31 years of service with the city. The last 10 of those 31 years was as director of planning. So this is where I say I have completing conflict. I'm happy and sad for him all at the same time. But we will certainly miss Mr. Chittum in his new endeavors, but we are certainly happy for his future endeavors. He has decided to provide services to local governments as a consultant in a different capacity, mainly in the Virginia and North Carolina area. So the good news is, fortunately, he will be able to remain in Roanoke. These are all of my comments.
Wow.
Thank you.
Wow. Well, when is the retirement date?
December 1st.
December 1st?
That's the way it works. It's always the first of the month.
Well, we want to, and I'm sure, and I'm just saying this personally, thank you, Chris, for your work and your commitment to this city for a number of years. And you and I have discussed a lot of things. We're sad to see you go, but wish you the best in your new endeavor. And the fact that you'll still be here in Roanoke, somebody will be calling you for certain things, don't they? But thank you for everything and your dedication to this community. It's been a pleasure working with you. All right. Anybody else? Vice Mayor?
Yeah, I'm very conflicted as well. I want to commend you for so many things, and I'll be able to do this more personally at another time, but thank you for what I think has been some pretty courageous leadership through a new comprehensive plan. Your department really led the way on pulling that together and taking the very progressive steps that we've taken to implement that plan. And I know there have been a lot of points of resistance, and I think you've handled those with grace, and I will always be grateful to you for providing, you and the department, for providing extraordinary leadership for us. Thank you, Chris.
Yes, ma'am. Well, she doesn't want to do it. She does that.
She confused me there a little bit. Well, Mr. Chatham, I certainly, echo everything everybody else has said, and I know that you have personally navigated me through some tough, challenging waters with Evan Springs, the zoning, a whole myriad of things that were very challenging, and, when somebody's leaving, you look back and say, wow, are we going to be able to replace that kind of leadership? Because we did depend on you a lot, and I'm just very sad to hear that you're leaving, but 30 years or however, what, I forgot already, 35, 30, 31 years still, that's a lot of years, that's a long time, so you've certainly earned it, well-deserved, and like I said, I want to personally thank you for helping navigate me through some of those tumultuous times. Thank you.
All right.
Mayor and Council, although we will likely formally recognize him in the next council member council meeting, I think it's appropriate to give him a round of applause.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Mayor, those concludes my comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Roman, let me ask you about one other point on your comment. I think it's number three, about the Belmont Lofts.
Yes.
They're going to be ready to for move in by November 1st?
That is definitely the goal. Yes, sir.
Oh. I don't know. Time goes by. I just thought this was an idea. All of a sudden, they're ready to go there. And that won't be the complete. That just will be part of them or the lot of.
I believe that will be a portion of them. However, we can get the answer to that question and give you a more concise update.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you. All right. Item 2A, City Attorney. We're asked to approve a contract to purchase Unit B, 1830 Blue Hills Circle Northeast, official tax map number 7280106 from Virginia Utility Protection Services Incorporated. There's an ordinance.
Move the ordinance.
Second.
Madam Clerk, can you please read the title paragraph?
An ordinance authorizing the city manager or her designee to execute the necessary documents providing for the purchase by the City of Roanoke, Virginia, of certain real property owned by Virginia Utility Protection Service, Inc., located in the City of Roanoke, Virginia, at Unit B, 1830 Blue Hill Circle Northeast, Roanoke, Virginia, designated as Roanoke Official Tax Map Number 7280106, upon certain terms and conditions, and dispensing with the second reading of this ordinance by title.
All right. Any discussion by members of council? All right. Hearing none. Madam Clerk, please call the roll on this.
Ms. White Boyd?
Aye.
Mr. Volleson?
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds?
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones? Vice Mayor Cobb?
Aye.
And Mayor Lee?
Aye. And the ordinance passes. Thank you. Item 8.1 is reports of committees. 8-1 is a report of the Roanoke City School Board requesting appropriation of funds for various educational programs, and a report of the interim city manager recommending, that council concur in the request. Donald Caldwell, Director of Accounting, is the spokesperson. There's a budget ordinance.
Move the budget ordinance.
Second.
Madam Clerk, please read the title paragraph.
An ordinance to appropriate funding from the Commonwealth, federal and private grant for various educational programs, amending and reordaining certain sections of the 2024-2025 school grant fund appropriations for the fiscal year 2025, and dispensing with the second reading by title of this ordinance.
All right. Any discussion by members of council? Hearing none, Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Ms. White Boyd?
Aye.
Mr. Volleson?
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds?
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb?
Aye.
And Mayor Lee?
Aye, and the budget ordinance passes. Thank you. Item number 8-2 is comments on certain authorities, boards, committees, and commissions in which city council serves as liaisons or appointees. So I'm going to ask council if they got any reports or comments that they want to make in this area on the various boards and committees that you do serve on. Well, seeing none, we'll go on to item number 9, which is unfinished business. Item number 10 is introduction and consideration of ordinances and resolutions. A resolution appointing a director of the Economic Development Authority of the City of Roanoke. All right, this is not the resolution that you sent. This is another. All right, so can I get a motion on this resolution?
So moved.
Second.
All right. Madam Clerk, please read the title paragraph.
Okay. A resolution appointing a director to the Board of Directors of the Economic Development Authority of the City of Roanoke, Virginia.
All right, any discussion? Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Ms. White Boyd?
Aye.
Mr. Volleson?
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds?
Aye.
Ms. Sanchez Jones?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb?
Aye.
Mayor Lee?
Aye, and the resolution passes. All right, item 10-2 is a resolution ratifying and confirming the retroactive declaration of local emergency by the interim city manager as the director of emergency management, conferring emergency powers in the interim city manager as director of emergency management. Is a resolution, is there?
Move the resolution.
Motion?
Second.
All right, Madam Clerk, can you read the title paragraph?
Yes, sir. A resolution ratifying and confirming the retroactive declaration of local emergency by the interim city manager as the director of emergency management, conferring emergency powers in the interim city manager as director of emergency management, authorizing interim city manager to make applications for federal and state public assistance to deal with such emergencies, designating a fiscal agent and an agent for submission of financial information for the city, and calling upon the federal and state governments for assistance.
All right, I'm pleased to recognize Trevor Shannon to come and share some comments with us about this. Trevor, thank you for your work in this area for a while in terms of emergency management and those things. You all do a good job down there. So can you inform the public what this all means and the council?
Yes, sir. Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of council, Deputy City Manager, thank y'all. So this is a retroactive declaration of emergency, and what that means is during the disaster of Tropical Storm Helene, We did not feel that our resources were overwhelmed to the point where we needed a declaration or an emergency declaration to go along with the state. Fortunately, our damages here were not nearly as bad as far southwest Virginia and some of the impacts that we saw in far southwest Virginia. We did have numerous teams stood up here, and thanks to all the work of our great partners, whether it was Public Works, Parks and Rec, or Police, Fire, and all of our other partners here working in the city. We did have almost 10,000 people without power, which led, you know, caused by a lot of down trees and pretty significant damages to us, but not that overwhelmed us because of the great work of our you know, workforce. But after the fact and talking to the Virginia Department of Emergency Management, the FEMA teams that have come down to support the region, we did learn that there were some costs incurred to the city that we were not aware of that would count for us for public damage assistance. One of the big ones was the Black Hawk helicopters landing at the Roanoke Regional Airport. So that cost alone that was incurred for the city of Roanoke is actually going to put us near that threshold where we felt like a declaration is necessary and warranted for this recovery process, as we still continue to manage the recovery. Talking to Director of Public Works, Mr. Campbell, the other day, they're still doing debris removal. And so we're still seeing costs add up. So we felt like it was important to go ahead and declare retroactively so that when we work with FEMA, which our meeting will be on October 28th at 9 a.m., we'll discuss this with FEMA and our VDEM partners to decide where we go from here and hope that we recover some of these costs that we've incurred over the storm.
All right. Any discussion by members of council? All right, thank you. Okay, Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Ms. White-Boyd?
Aye.
Ms. Volleson?
Aye.
Ms. Moon Reynolds is out. Ms. Sanchez Jones?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Cobb?
Aye.
And Mayor Lee?
Aye. And the resolution passes. Trevor, let me thank you for your work, as I said earlier, in the community when it comes to things such as how we operate in emergency situations or pandemics and those kind of things. And I remember how you go out and visit with churches and tell them how to prepare things and give them information on that. I want to say thank you personally now, because I may not see you in the four meetings I got left, but thank you for all that you're doing, have done, and we're pleased with the process as we go about it. And I'm thankful that we weren't hit as other communities were with this past, with Helene and Milton there. It did a lot of damage, so thank you all for what you do. All right, the resolution passed? Okay. Item number 11 is motion of miscellaneous business. Inquiry with the comments by the mayor and the members of the city council. All right. Did anybody here attend the goal?
Please, yeah.
Sir.
I was just about to say, I wanted to say thank you to all the volunteers and staff that made GoFest possible. And thank you for the nice weather.
Thank the mayor for that.
Yeah. I tried to do that.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
So thank you for all that, all the folks that helped out with that. It was an amazing time downtown, and I look forward to seeing if we can beat the attendance next year.
Well,
thank you. Let me just say that something I forgot to share at our last meeting, but I think it's been a couple of weeks now that Councilwoman Tush White-Boyd and I went to South Boston, Virginia, where they unveiled the statue of Henrietta Lacks. You know, she was a native. She was born here, but she moved at an early age to Halifax County. And they unveiled the statue there, and it was very impressive.
Very impressive.
Very impressive. And we commend that, and I commend what we've done and what Ms. White-Boyd and her work in terms of getting that statue here and then down in South Boston. And they had a real big crowd down there, and had, I think, every board of supervisors and city town councils all around that area were there. And it was a good event, and I had a chance to make a few comments on behalf of where we were and what Roanoke's role in that. So I just wanted to let you know that it went very well, and we have some pictures. You see the picture. But the statue's in a different position than it was here.
Hands on her hips.
So she said. So, but anyway, Henrietta Lacks
lives on.
Yeah, lives on. Her cell still there. All right.
I was gonna just highlight a couple additional things that happened this weekend. The Taubman Museum of Art had a opening night, kind of a street party for a new exhibit called Eternally New: The Art Nouveau World of Alphonse Mucha. And it was extraordinary. There were probably well over 1,000 people who attended that. Wow. And dancers from Southwest Virginia Ballet. If you get a chance to see the exhibit, it's really extraordinary. It's very interactive and immersive. And then on Sunday, there was a great Faith in Blue event held at Williams Memorial Baptist Church. Sheriff's Department, Police Department, Fire-EMS turned out, and there was a really extraordinary program talking about a lot of the efforts taking place to address and reduce gun violence in the community. So I just wanted to make sure we celebrate these important things that are happening.
Thank you. Look, I would maybe get by there. Yep.
One more thing I forgot about is, well, we went to VML last week.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to recognize, Deputy City Manager O'Brien, who was there with us, with also the library's team, because Roanoke won an innovation award this year for lock-in safety, unlock hope. So just wanted to flag that, and congratulations to everybody that was involved.
Thank you, Peter. At least I'm not the only one forgetting things. That helps me. You know, when you're a young man, you can.
I know. I won't remember anything by it.
Thank you so much. And we appreciate that, and the good work that Deputy City Manager O'Brien and Sheila Umberg and her staff were all there. And always enjoy being up and being Roanoke, being recognized as a city for innovative award, and so it's a good thing. All right, if there is no other business, this session, council session, will stand in recess for a closed meeting, and we will reconvene at 7 o'clock tonight here in the chamber. Thank you.
To address a dangerous moment in the Middle East. Earlier this hour, we heard from a supporter and former advisor to Vice President Kamala Harris. Now we'll hear from a supporter of former President Donald Trump.
Richard Goldberg served on the National Security Council under Trump and is now with the Foundation for Defense of Democracies in Washington. We spoke this